So Tope, do you have your book handy? And if so, do you have just a few paragraphs you could read so that those who may not know your work have a taste of what we'll be talking about for the next hour or so? Oh, there it is. Yeah.
Oh, there it is too. Hi, book. I'll read a couple. I'll read just from the beginning, a few paragraphs. She told me I could serve her in heaven. She accompanied me to school each day. School was about a mile away and a few hundred feet into my trek. Just as my family's apartment building drifted out of view behind me, she would appear at my side. I don't remember how she looked. Memory often summons a generic figure in her place, an elderly white woman with frizzled gray hair, slightly bent over, a smile featuring an assortment of gaps and silver linings. I do remember her touch, however. It felt cool and papery, disarmingly comfortable on the hottest days of fall. She would often pat my head as we walked together, and a penetrating silence would cancel the morning sounds around us. I felt comfortable, protected somehow in her presence. She never walked all the way to school with me, but her parting words were always the same. Remember, if you are a good boy here on earth, you can serve me in heaven. I was 5 years old. Her words sounded magical to me, vast and alluring. I didn't know her. I barely knew her name, but the offer she held out to me each morning seemed far too generous to dismiss lightly. In class, I would think about what servitude in heaven would be like. I imagined myself carrying buckets of water for her on streets of gold, rubbing her feet as angels sang praises in the background. I imagined that I'd have my own heavenly shack. I'd have time to do my own personal heavenly things as well. How else would I get to heaven? One day I told my father about her offer. We were talking about heaven, a favorite subject of his, and I mentioned that I already had a place there. I've already found someone to serve, I said. What do you mean? Dad smiled warmly at me. I felt his love. I repeated myself, Daddy, I'm going to heaven. And how are you going to get there? He said. I told him about the old lady, my heavenly shack, the streets of gold. My father stared at me a moment, grief and sadness surging briefly to the surface of his face, and then anger. He leaned forward, stared into my eyes. Listen to me now. The only person you will serve in heaven is God. You will serve no one else.
I went back and I've heard you read from that. I've read it several times myself now. So that is, if you haven't read that opening section of the book, it is beautiful and devastating. And anyway, I'm sighing at it. That's what I'm having right now. So let's get into our chat. So,
sure.
So who are you? Just a quick rundown too. So we've heard your words. Now let's just real quickly, for those who may not know you, in 500 words or less.
Okay. Job interview time. 500 words or less. Let's see. Okay. My name is Tope Folarin. I'm a writer. I do other things. I work as during the day, I suppose you could say. I work as a vice president for content and storytelling at a institution called the Local Initiative Support Corporation, which is the largest community development financial institution in the country. I'm also a father of two young children. One is three, the other is 4 months. So we went ahead and had a coronavirus baby, I suppose. So thankfully she doesn't have the coronavirus. In addition to that, let's see. I'm a reader. I love to read. I love to write. I love to not sleep, apparently, as well. So I guess that's my 500 word bio.
Nice. I was going to say, so we saw each other. The hardcovers of the books came out on the same day.
Yeah.
And so I felt like we probably would have run into each other at some point, but then the world happened. So we've not seen each other since. We had a chat in like the third week of book release or something. And I think we saw each other somewhere else since then.
Yeah.
So you've had you and your wife have had another child.
Yeah. Yeah. Happened March 18th. And so, you know, it was really weird. I mean, we had these incredible plans in place because the first one was so difficult, like just over 3 years ago. And so, you know, my parents were going to come up, and then we had friends that were going to help out, and we had this whole kind of food delivery system thing worked out. And, you know, and then the coronavirus happens, and there was actually a conversation. I had to have like a really robust conversation with the doctor about whether I'd actually be allowed into the operating theater to see the baby delivered, just because they were so, I guess, frightened about what could happen. And so, and we've been inside since then. So not quite the not quite what we had in mind for this period of our lives, but you know, everyone's healthy, so we're happy about that.
One of our neighbors here in the apartment complex I live in had a baby recently, and occasionally I see him, like, he has weird hours at work, so I'll be going to work in the afternoon and I'll see him looking, obviously didn't work for a while, but he's at he has to go in sometimes, and he will look so exhausted, like this slow slump on the sidewalk. Like, I want to say, go, I can't give you a hug, man. I give you a hug right now. Not coronavirus times. But yeah.
So, I've never been more tired in my life. I can honestly say that. I have never been more tired.
So I empathize indirectly. I can't know it personally, but I feel for you. So let's talk. So one of the things that's always on my list of questions is the author's journey as a writer and their publication journey. And then we always, speaking of which, in the chat window, if anyone has questions, please type your questions into the chat window and we'll get to as many as possible throughout the course of our chat. If you can't find the chat window, it's the little button that you hover over at the bottom of the screen if you're on a PC. So it's always at the end, this question about publishing, and so I never get to it. But I feel like you've had like almost exactly 12 months now of book having been published, plus this all the stuff that goes before then. So I wanted to start on that this time, because many of the people who come from the Writer Center community especially are interested in the publication side of things.
Sure.
So how did this book just broadly go from an idea to a physical object? What was the overview of the journey?
Yeah, it's been quite a journey. So I was actually reflecting on this just a couple weeks ago. I started thinking about this book 10 years ago, back in 2010. And you know, my life was completely different then. And I had been an avid reader for most of my life and had really been avidly reading sort of contemporary fiction at that point for about 5 years. And so I felt I had something to say, and I felt that I had been developing the kind of skill set to say those things. And so I just started writing. I don't have an MFA, and I was really kind of sensitive about that because I recognized that a number of people who, younger folk, I guess, and older as well now as time passes, who are able to publish their debut novels have gone through that process. And I hadn't gone through that process. And so I just figured, you know, I have to study and read as much as I can. And so I started doing that. And it was an arduous path, to be honest. I think, you know, what happened was I had this sense of what the book could possibly be. And I started writing it. And, you know, I kind of underestimated, I guess, the importance of networks for writers and how desperately important that is. Even today, I think there are a number of kind of writers who know each other on social media, or they all live in Brooklyn together. And so they're able to recommend, you know, one another for various things. And that kind of system enables all of them to kind of establish a foothold in this really precarious kind of system of creative writing. And if you don't have those advantages, it can be difficult. You know, one of the advantages that I had, though, is that I live in DC, and I spent a lot of time going to every single book reading that I could. You know, I went to every artist talk that I could, kind of inspired by something I'd read when I was in grad school by Susan Sontag. She had talked about the process of just becoming a better artist and how for her that was about kind of immersing herself in the process of art, whether it was going to the museum all the time or listening to what artists had to say, not just in her chosen discipline, but other disciplines as well. So I was really driven in that sense to do that. And I did that for a few years. And I have to say, like, I sent out short stories for about 2 years. Nobody ever picked up a story. I had, like many writers, I had the Excel spreadsheet. And I think I was at 150 rejections before I got my first acceptance in late 2012 for a magazine called Transition Magazine. Amy, for Transition Magazine, which is based out of Harvard University. So that was the first story I ever published. And I was really excited about the fact that it was published. And I remember very earnestly kind of talking about it in my Facebook and Twitter feeds and no one responding and no one really caring. So, and then putting my email address in my bio and, you know, in the magazine, and not a single person emailing me. But, you know, I was very much, a couple of my friends back in high school, they were like aspiring musicians, aspiring rappers, and they had a habit of like carrying their mixtapes or their demos or whatever around with them everywhere. So I started carrying my stories around with me everywhere because I was going to so many book talks. And I met a writer that I admired who lives here in DC as well. His name is Helen Habila. And one day I just kind of accosted him after a reading, and I kind of shoved my story in his hand and then walked away. And he called me because he had to get on the metro, the subway here. And when he got off the subway, he, you know, sort of called me back and said, you know, I think you might have something here. And so that's why I submitted that story, the first story I published for the Caine Prize for African Writing. Fast forward about 6 months, I won that prize. And my life completely changed at that point, because the Caine Prize for African Writing is, it's maybe the most prestigious literary prize for Africa, even though it's given out in the UK. And so after that, you know, I met a bunch of agents and writers, and I was really kind of, I guess, ushered into this world of like professional writing. And that's when my trajectory really shifted, because I got an agent, and then the process, and we've talked about this, Zach, of trying to get a novel out the door, my goodness, you know, just in the interest of full candor, I think my agent sent out the book to 25 publishers before somebody kind of took the bait, as it were. And so I think that's how it is sometimes, especially if you're doing something that's not expected, you know, like a lot of people, and maybe we'll talk about marketing and the way the novel's perceived a bit later on, but because of my name, I have a Nigerian name. I was born and raised in this country, but there's a sense that I'm not of this country, if you will, especially since I won the Caine Prize for African Writing. And they were trying to kind of, they wanted me to position myself as an immigrant writer, which I am not. And so because I was kind of refusing to kind of accept that immigrant writer label, I think some publishers were skittish about the prospect of trying to launch something new. And so I was finally able to connect with this wonderful editor at Simon and Schuster, a guy named Ira Silverberg, who I completely got the book. I mean, it's the moment that I think most writers dream of. He saw the book, and within a day he called me on my cell phone and said, I'm going to acquire this, and we're going to make this great together. And so that was the process. And then roughly 18 months later, the book came out.
Yeah. So I think you've covered leading up to publication a little bit, which I was going to ask about explicitly, but I think, and we might get back to that a little bit, but what was your experience after publication? Because I think the last time we talked at length was still in the throes of book tour. Mm-hmm. So I don't think we've touched base. So what happened after publication, and broadly, and then specifically, what were there any surprises? Were there any particularly exciting things? Was there anything that was particularly a slog that you had to go through in the 12 months since then?
Yeah. Gosh, I don't think there's any preparation for it. I mean, I guess many of us are writers, so I think it's probably safe for me to say that a number of us kind of dream of this moment, right? Of the moment of getting your book published. And those first few weeks are a bit of a whirlwind, you know, like the publisher oftentimes we'll set up a bit of a tour. And so I, you know, was fortunate enough to go to a few places. And it's really interesting to kind of, again, it's that you have to switch in the mind between being a creator and an artist to all of a sudden being a marketer and a salesperson and all kinds of things that you're not spending a lot of time thinking about. And also about the process of putting yourself out there and what that means. And for some people that comes naturally, for others, not so much. I think for me, I'm happy to be out in public, but, definitely, I had to shift the way that I thought about the novel. You know, like I was tempted to talk about, you know, some of my influences or maybe the things that didn't necessarily fit with the script. And as time passed, I began to get a sense of this idea that some people, I'd say in the media, perhaps I guess more than anywhere else, they were sensitive to the idea that I wasn't presenting what I was meant to present. So to be less cryptic, you know, I had the great fortune, for example, of doing a couple interviews on NPR and talking with other radio stations around the country and even doing a couple TV things. And in all those cases, I guess you have some harried producer somewhere who's like, okay, they probably didn't read the book, but they have this general sense of what it is you're supposed to be doing. And they ask you questions according to that template. So again, you're Tope Folarin, your parents are from Nigeria, and they start asking you a series of questions that might not be related to the book. So in those moments, you have a choice of whether you're gonna like be the contrarian and the difficult person, or you're just gonna go along with the flow. And it's a kind of instant calculation, right? Like, cause you're thinking to yourself like, okay, if I am a contrarian right now, they might not invite me back, or I'll be labeled as difficult person. But if I don't do that, then people might have a sense that this book is something that it's actually not. And I think it's just a difficulty too of just, you know, being a debut novelist, of trying to establish a new kind of parameters or a new kind of artistic zone for yourself, if you will, which is something that I'm desperately interested in doing. And so I just basically had to kind of ride that line a little bit and, you know, sort of smile during those interviews and answer the questions as fully as I could, and then to the extent that I could also interject more of myself and more of what I was trying to do in that process.
So I didn't have this on the script, but what is the fewest number of attendees at a reading event that you had in any book tour event?
That's a great question. You know, I was fortunate in that like a lot of my events were pretty well attended, so that was great. But I had this experience where I was in, so part of my tour was in Nigeria, and I went off to Lagos for like a week for like, you know, activities. And when I was there, my publicist reached out to me and she said, hey, there's a bookstore in DC called Solid State Books. Shout out to Solid State Books. They want to have you in. They've heard some good things. And I'm like, yeah, I'd love to do that. I've heard great things myself. I hadn't been there before. And so I get off the plane and I'm terribly jet lagged. And a couple of hours later, I go off to Solid State Books. And I don't think there's anyone there. You know, I walk up and no one's there. It's devastating. You're like, wow. Especially because, you know, I've gone from, you know, in Lagos, you know, these crowds of people who were out there to like no one showing up. And this is the city I've made my home for the past, you know, 10 plus years. So, you know, I'm just kind of awkwardly sitting around, and the person who invited me is up there as well. And we're kind of looking there. And I can see she feels sorry for me because I'm feeling sorry for myself. And she may have called a friend or something, because within like 5 minutes, about five people walked in. And by the time I started talking, I think we had a solid, robust audience of 10. And so that was, but it was rough going there initially.
I'm just going to say though, that 10 people is like, that's to die for in like book reading numbers. I don't think I've told this story before. When I was in Pittsburgh, I went to Pittsburgh on my tour, and I think five people showed up.
Yeah.
And one of them was my Uber driver from earlier in the day from the airport. So I talked to him, nice. Chatted to him, and he actually showed up. So like I marketed myself for one of the five attendees on the ride from the airport.
But the thing, and I learned that the thing that's really important about that is that, so for example, my small audience is Solid State Books. Two of the people had read the book and they cared a lot about the book, and they had like really wonderful questions for me. And so I just had this moment where I was like, okay, I need to stop being selfish and like sort of full of myself, because two people broke away from their days, whatever that may mean for them, whether it's like coming here from work or not watching their favorite Bravo reality television program. I say this as somebody who loves Bravo, so I'm not at all hating on that. And they came over here and they're sitting in the audience to like engage with my work. And that's a wonderful thing. So, you know, and that's what this experience is about. Like I've sat, you know, in a room by myself writing for a long time. And the hope is that like my words touch somebody in some way enough to convince them or to compel them to get up and come out to a bookstore or to get on a Zoom at 5 p.m. or whatever time it may be right now and wherever the part of the country you are and listen to what I have to say. That's the point of this. That's why it's such an incredible experience. And so, I was shaken loose from my kind of throes of selfishness after I had a couple conversations with those folks.
On a previous comment, so what is this is from Karen in the chat, what is the new kind of zone you're trying to establish for yourself?
Yeah, it's a really good question. You know, I think about like the writers who influenced me. This wasn't a question that people asked me a lot when I was on tour. I mean, there were assumptions about the writers who influenced me. But, you know, I read a lot of, you know, Kafka was one of the writers who, and he influences like just about, if not everyone, a whole bunch of folks, but he was very important to me, and Borges. And when I started reading literary fiction, those are the folks that I read a lot. And then I read this book that was released 10 years called Reality Fiction by David Shields. And many people believe that that book kind of inaugurated this trend of contemporary fiction that's called autofiction. And, you know, people writing about their lives, which is something that writers have done, let's be frank, probably since the beginning of novels. But, you know, I guess it's been more formalized of late. But it's interesting if you think about, like, autofiction. It's a genre I love. You know, I'm actually reading a book called Drifts right now, which was published, I think, a couple months ago. And a lot of times when, because the critical thing that happens too is that part of the way that you get your work out there is criticism, right? Like critics will opine on the book and say, this is a book that's worth reading or not. And I think that has to do too with the network of people who are connected, and maybe at some dinner party, somebody will say, oh, you should read this book. It's a really good book. Or this person was my student. I know they're a great writer. You should pick up this book. So the question becomes, what happens if you're not part of those networks? And I'm writing autofiction. My book is more or less a piece of autofiction, but it wasn't reviewed in that way. And for me, that was somewhat surprising, you know. It was reviewed more or less as a piece of a coming of age fiction or immigrant fiction. And you know, and I wanted to push that autofiction thing a bit out there. You know, I'm not convinced that there's, for example, a distinction between fiction and nonfiction. And that might sound sacrilegious in some circles, but I wanted to write right on that line between fiction and nonfiction to kind of insist that there's this wonderfully generative space between or on the line between the two. And that's the place from which I wrote. And I was anticipating conversations about that, but all the conversations and kind of circled back to, oh, so, you know, the protagonist's father came from Nigeria, or, you know, that sort of thing. So that's what I was endeavoring to do as a writer. And I actually kind of wrote this piece for LitHub right when the book came out, that kind of explained some of my aims and talked about my influences, which, you know, including Abbas Kiarostami, the great Iranian filmmaker, who's one of my artistic lodestars and people like him. So I think that's kind of the thing I was influenced by.
One thing that people don't realize, and by people I mean even authors heading into publishing process, that how much of the perception of the book is driven by the marketing department if you're publishing with a major house. I think in my experience, and this is all said with hindsight and no intended criticism of my publisher, the publisher wants to sell books. They approach your book with good faith the whole time. So this is looking back and thinking things, but my book is literary fiction, but there's a touch of speculative sci-fi element to it. And I feel like there was marketing expenditure put towards that, which maybe didn't pay off in the long run for the long-term, like where I might've actually fit in with the literary, anyway, all hindsight, I don't know for sure, but that was a marketing decision. That was the marketing department deciding, this is how we sell the most books. If you publish with one of the big publishers, their number one concern is bottom line. Your editor, the person who's helping you finish the book and get it readable, they have to do a business report basically of what this book is going to do in the market and how they justify acquiring it and paying you the money they pay you. So I think that's missed sometimes, and that's for better or worse, I think often for worse, it pushes you in a direction where you as an author didn't necessarily intend to go.
That's so true. And I think that, but it depends on who's in that room having the conversation about, and to the extent they relate to that, because we're all human beings, you know, they're human beings in the literary business who are making decisions about the kinds of books that'll get spotlighted and how those books will receive attention. And so if no one in the room really gets where you're coming from or your perspective, or doesn't know much about the kind of culture you emerge from, that can be a difficult conversation. And in my case, my editor left the house about 6 months before the book came out. So my book was orphaned, and a new editor came on board, and she was wonderful, but she hadn't acquired the book. And I don't say this to malign her at all, because I think she did a great job, but it wasn't something that she had sought out. We hadn't had those conversations about the book beforehand. And so I think that influences the trajectory of the life of the book inside the house as well.
I think too, if any of you subscribe to the Writers Center magazine, which will be going out, actually, I think it mailed today, in fact, we have an interview with the novelist Diane Zinna, an essay by the novelist Diane Zinna, and she writes about a similar situation where her first book, the editor left, her book died for four years before she got it published. But it's a weird industry.
Yeah.
So if someone came to you today and asked, what would you tell them they should know about the publishing process? What's the big thing you'd share with them right now?
Goodness gracious. I would say the thing that I would do if I did anything differently would be to have, and this is asking a lot because we're artists, so we're not sort of thinking in these terms necessarily, but I think you should have in mind what audience there is for your book and how you would market your book to the audience, because that means that you have some of the control. Otherwise, I think most debut novelists go into it and they say to themselves, the house has been doing this for years, they've obviously had success, they know how to do this. And I think the thing you may find is that they might kind of put you into a lane where you don't necessarily fit. But if you're able to make a pitch for yourself to say, hey, I know that, you know, you might think of it this way, but here's why I think the book actually belongs here. And here are potential outlets, you know, that that might be responsive to this way of thinking about the book. I think the other thing too is to like have maybe a piece or two of writing, I'd say have an op-ed perhaps that you can pitch to folks just to kind of establish yourself as a voice. And maybe a piece about like why you wrote the book, right? And why this book is necessary. And so the Lit Hub piece I mentioned before was a piece about like me kind of attempting to establish why I did this in my own words, not mediated through the publishing house, which has its own aims and concerns. And so I think those would be the two things that I would do. The other thing too, since we're having a real honest conversation about this, is that like there are a number of like hired guns that are working on behalf or within publishers right now, publicists who, and I was really nervous about this, to be honest, because I knew some of my friends who also had debut novelists had shelled out $15,000, $20,000, $25,000 to hire a publicist to get their work out there. And that's the thing that's happening. It's a kind of arms race that's occurring in the literary fiction world right now. It's just because, let's be honest, you know, there's a lot of books and not as many eyes perhaps as there need to be to kind of read all these books and give these books attention. And so that was something I thought about too. And for a moment, I almost succumbed to the urge of hiring a publicist and shelling out that money. But I eventually did, and I'm glad that I did not. But I think that's something else to think about, about maybe the prudence of doing that. Again, I don't think we should have to do it. And I think that's a kind of unfortunate reality in this marketplace right now. But it is something that is out there that perhaps is worth sort of pondering.
And what one of the friends of the Writer Center, John Copenhaver, I know did have an outside publicist for his book to great success. So that it does, if the right publicist, yeah. It does make a difference. I mean, it's the writing is hopefully an art, but the selling, the writing is a business.
Exactly.
So to the chat for a question, yeah. I appreciate that you read a lot. What genre mostly? Who's your favorite author, biggest influence, or author's influences? I added that plural just in case you don't want to name one.
Such a hard question to answer, right? You know, like I mentioned at the beginning, like Kafka and Borges, and those were people that were important to me. And then for about, I would say for maybe 3 years, I didn't read anything but poetry. And so just reading poetry, I was convinced that I was gonna, my first book would be a book of poems. And I'm really glad I did that because I think that it helped my writing immeasurably and helped the way that I think as well. And I became a more perceptive reader and writer as a result of my sort of ongoing engagement with poetry. And then, and so when I was reading poetry, I was reading everybody. I was reading Mark Strand, I was reading, so many people were really important to me, and I'm blanking now because I've slept 2 hours, but a number of people, that'll come to me later, a number of poets were deeply important to me, and I kind of was really engaging with that world for quite a long time. A lot of the Kaveh Khanum poets, for example, are folks that I kind of returned to. And then after that, I came around and I started kind of re-engaging literary fiction. I was reading a lot of autofiction again at that point. So I was reading people like Sheila Hetty and Teju Cole, and of course like Ben Lerner and those kinds of folks. And I was really interested in some of the stuff that they were doing. And so I think that I'm probably still in that space in terms of reading like a lot of autofiction, and because I'm just interested in like the cutting edge. You know, like I'm the kind of person who, I spend a lot of time at museums. If I'm going into a museum, I'll rush to like the kind of contemporary wing to get a sense of what's happening today or what was happening 2 or 3 years ago. And so I'm interested in that cutting edge, and I'm interested in kind of shaping an idea of where fiction can go in the 21st century.
I think one thing that like fiction writers sometimes don't get, especially if your focus is lit fic, is read poetry.
Mm.
Read it's poetry essential. Yeah. Every yeah. day.
Yeah. If it's a single poem, like that's a practice that I think you have to do, really.
Yeah, it's we neglect it to our own peril.
The major poet I read was Tomas Tranströmer. That is, like I mentioned, like sort of my literary, I mean, the people that I am obsessed with, he is there. I mean, I would say Tranströmer, I'd say Kiarostami, I'd say Alice Munro is somebody who's deeply important to me. I mean, these are folks who I've read and have, they never lead me astray. And so Baldwin, of course, is in that pantheon as well. So, the great, Maya Angelou is somebody that I care deeply about as well. Toni Morrison is, if not at the very top, and she certainly maybe 1A. So, I mean, these are all people who have deeply influenced me.
So now that we're halfway through, Janet's asked, haven't read your book yet, what is the general arc of your story? The introductory passage suggests the possible of magical realism to me, or it could be literal. Yep. So let's clarify on that real quick, and we'll move on from there.
Yeah, it's a story about a kid who is trying to, I guess the best way of putting it is that he is trying to construct an identity. He doesn't know who he is. And if you progress a little bit further in the book, you'll discover that there's somebody who is in his early 20s who's writing the book. And he's trying to figure out, he's going into his past to get a sense of how he ended up where he is. And I guess if there's a thesis, and I guess this is the old academic in me that's coming out, if there's a thesis to the book, it's this idea that I think many of us are kind of handed an identity card when we're born. You know, like your parents say, this is who you are. And it might not be, it's just a kind of accumulation of cultural influences and the way your parents interact with each other and the way they talk, the kinds of music they bring into your house, the kind of food you eat, all those kinds of things. And I think for a lot of people, what's happening in the house more or less rhymes with what's happening outside the house, right? So, you know, if you're growing up, you might be eating hamburgers in your house, you're probably eating hamburgers outside as well. You know, you're speaking English in the house, you're speaking English outside as well. What happens if you're born in a situation in which, you know, there's an entire different set of practices that are happening in the home as opposed to outside? That happens for a lot of people. And the question becomes, how do you decide who you are? Is it one? Is it the other? Is it a combination of both? And then race complicates that a little bit as well. You know, if you're an Italian immigrant and you don't speak any English, there are perhaps certain points of association that you can draw from American culture. If you're like me and your parents are from Nigeria and you're born as a Black person in the middle of Utah, then that identity question is complicated even more. And so it's a book about how someone comes to be, basically, and how fraught that process can be.
So I think this next question from chat also, it maybe is the next step in what you're just talking about. So considering the title of the book, how does the story deal with not being Black enough from the post-civil rights Black American perspective?
Yeah, it's a great question. Just because that too was a really kind of complicated, thorny issue. I guess the one thing that I would say is that especially if you're growing up in a place, I think if you're growing up in a place with a lot of people of color, a lot of Black people, that you recognize that there is great diversity in those communities, right? If you're growing up in a place with a lot of Black folk, then you'll have, you know, the kind of intellectual aunt, you know, the crazy uncle, you know, at the cookout, all kinds of people are coming through, all different kinds of personalities. If you're not growing up in that context, what happens is that people kind of form this opinion of who you are based on the way you are. And that opinion that they form doesn't have room for diversity. It is what is typically referred to as a stereotype. And an all human beings stereotype, in order to kind of make the world more comprehensible. If you're growing up in a situation in which people have a general stereotype about people like you based on the way you look, it can be incredibly difficult to break out of that. And so the book is partly focused on that question, and that's why it's entitled The Particular Kind of Black Man. Because I think if you, even in this incredible moment, and I say incredible because we have had difficult moments over the course of the past couple of months with the murders of George Floyd, Ahmaud Arbery, Breonna Taylor, and onwards. But I think anything kind of great has happened as a result of that. It's the biggest protest movement in the history of this country. And you think about everything that's happened in this country, that's quite a thing to say, and it's incredibly important. But even in the midst of that, I think if you cornered, you know, a number of people in a number of parts of this country and said, okay, describe a Black man for me, you know, once they got past their, you know, if they did so in a free way, if they'd had a couple of these, you know, I think that they would say certain things that were, you know, probably interesting or probably problematic. And so part of the book is querying that idea of what it means to be a Black man and asserting too that that there is diversity within that sort of category that has been maligned for so long in this country's history.
So shifting from content back to craft a little bit, a follow-up to our poetry discussion. How did reading poetry influence your writing process? And I'll jump in real quick and just say that poets think about the arrangement of words more deeply and more thoughtfully and practice the arrangement of words more deeply and thoughtfully than any other writers in general.
Yeah.
So if you're studying poetry, you're studying people who are thinking about words more deeply than other people tend to think about words. So it's sort of this, that's one of the things, it's not the only reason, but that's one of the reasons that I like poetry as a practice.
Yeah, absolutely. I think of poetry as a kind of lab. It's where new language happens. You know, it's like, if you want to be where the new language is happening right now, you know, folks like today, people like Dennis Smith is an example of somebody who I think is doing really exciting things with poetry. People who are creating new, Kevin Young is another, I mean, there are all kinds of people who are doing incredibly important work right now. And I think they're creating new languages and new ways of being. For me, there was a moment when I was really completely taken with Scandinavian poets. And the way this happened was that I was reading Ted Kooser, who was formerly a poet laureate of the US. And I was really fond of his poems. I was reading Ted Kooser and Kay Ryan. For a moment, those were two of my favorite poets. And so I wanted to learn how to write poetry like Ted Kooser. And so Ted Kooser released a book about writing poetry from a very, very small press. And I managed to get it after visiting a number of like independent bookstore websites. And it came in, and I was really interested in his treatment of metaphor, because I think he has a really solid sense of metaphor, and I'm obsessed with metaphor. And so I went directly into the section of the book on metaphor, and he talks about how he was influenced by a poet that I never heard of named Tomáš Tranströmer. And he cited a section of the poetry which inspired him to read Tranströmer. And the section goes, they put the light off, and its white globe glowed for an instant and then dissolved like a tablet of light in a glass of darkness. And I read that and I was like, wow, that's a really fascinating way of sort of arranging language. I'd never kind of engaged with something like that before. And so I started reading Tranströmer, Robert Bly, who was one of his main US translators. And that for me was really important. And I think it was that process of like really engaging with language that, because I was already in love with language. But it really kind of put me in a place where I began to kind of think about writing on a sentence to sentence and word to word level in a way that I hadn't before. And it is by far the most important thing that I've ever done with respect to the craft of writing and becoming a better writer. I guess when I started doing this, I was actually unemployed, which for me was a major source of embarrassment because I kind of worked really hard in school, so that would never happen. And I was in a place where, I wanted to be a poet. And so I'm just reading lots of poems and I'm kind of wandering around and reading poems and going to politics and prose and reading there. And when I was in college, I had this wonderful professor, her name was Dr. Carol Ann Taylor. And every week she made us memorize a poem and recite it in class. It's a practice I hated at the time. I thought like, why am I doing this? I would like fret. I would try to memorize, like cram the poem the night before because I was doing college things. But I kind of earnestly took up this practice during this period of unemployment. And every week I try to memorize a poem and I'd walk around committing a poem to memory. And it's fascinating what happens when you allow language to live inside of you like that. I think that you have no control over the process, but you are becoming a better writer when you are kind of engaging in a deep way with polished language. It changes the way that you think about the world and the way you think about language.
So we have greetings from a fellow Morehouse brother. Hey. A couple practical questions for you. Do you outline your story before writing it? And do you write every day?
I am not. You know, the funny thing is with this book, I didn't outline, but I'm working on a novel right now. There has been some outlining. I'll admit to that. And I say this, I admit to it because I was somebody who was very much against outlining for, I don't know why. I don't know if I thought I was like being more artistic if I didn't outline, but you know, like now I'm doing lots of outlining. So it's been helpful. And I don't necessarily think I'll kind of adhere to the outline, but it's important in terms of like thinking about where the story wants to go. I think the thing that we all know as writers though, is that once you start writing, the story will do its own thing. So, but it's helpful to kind of have a sense, a framework in place. Writing every day. Yeah, that's something that I'm pretty religious about. And I use that term intentionally because even in this moment, which, you know, I have night duty with the baby and I have a day job and all kinds of other things are happening. Like it's the way that I kind of, it's like exercise. Cause I'm the kind of person like, you know, I call myself a jogger, but if I stop jogging for like a day and a half, then I'm not a jogger anymore. I'm like, you know what, that's painful. And writing can be the same way, even though I love to write. The thing that I find is that if I don't write for a night or two, like it can then quickly become a week. And I understand too that like much of this is a matter of having the time to do it. There is a class dimension to becoming a good writer, right? Like having the space to think about it, having the space to actually write. And so I'm aware of that. But the thing that I do is that even if I write a paragraph, you know, that's something I try to do to kind of keep the practice up, to get better and to continue to kind of, you know, sort of be in this world where my mind is engaged in a creative manner.
I'll follow up too and just add that there are lots of different writing methods that still count as being writer.
Yeah.
And if you ask that question of do you write every day across a lot of writers, the answers will be very different. So I think writing every day is a standard way that successful writers do operate, but there are other ways as well that successful writers operate.
One of my favorite, one of my friends who produces incredible work, and she writes, she says, whenever the spirit moves her. And in the process, you know, her mind's building up. She's forming story. So, I mean, that's probably maybe a better way, because then you're not having to draft and redraft 40 million times, you know, if you have a solid sense of story before you start that process.
You mentioned Baldwin as a touchstone for your writing.
Yeah.
Is there a particular aspect of his writing for you that you found struck you most?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think two things. I hadn't read Baldwin before I went to college, and I actually read Baldwin for the first time. I spent a year at Bates College in Lewiston, Maine. And I mentioned before Dr. Taylor, who was one of the most important, I mean, I guess we all have like an instructor or professor who's important. She was that person for me. And I think second week of class, she kind of pulled me aside and said, I think you need to read Baldwin. And I knew about James Baldwin. And she's like, have you read him? And I was like, yeah, I've read him. And she's like, what have you read? I was like, well, I don't know. And then she said, you should read Go Tell It on the Mountain by James Baldwin. And so that's his first novel, actually. And it was a really perceptive call on her part, because it's a book about a protagonist who is kind of grappling with a really sort of stern father, which is something I can relate to. I had a stern father who was very deeply religious. That is my life as well. And so it was one of the first times that I'd actually seen myself in fiction, and I saw like a space for myself in fiction. Because, you know, like I think a number of us grow up thinking, there isn't really a space for me in literature. Literature is about other people. It's about other people out there. And I enjoy these stories deeply, but they're not necessarily about my family and me. And reading Go Tell It on the Mountain was this kind of really, it's this wonderful introduction to a world of writers who are writing about situations and conditions that I could directly relate to. And so I love that book. I inhaled it. I read it again. And then I read his next book, Giovanni's Room, and I became kind of besotted with Baldwin as a fiction writer. I think it was later in college that I started reading his nonfiction. I came across a copy of The Fire Next Time and started reading that, and that was incredible for me. And so, and I love the fact that he has like a distinct kind of fictional voice and perspective, and a distinct kind of non-fictional voice or perspective, if you will. And that's something I aspire to as well. You know, he's a wonderful essayist. I think he's more widely known perhaps as a essayist than as a fiction writer. And I think that speaks to his range, and that speaks to an ambition that I hold as well.
So this next question I'm going to comment on first, because the answering it is part of what I do at the Writer Center when people come in with questions. Sure. But Tope, if you want to, please pitch in as well after this. So do you recommend that an aspiring novelist complete a novel before pursuing insight from an editor or publisher, or pitch the idea during the process of writing in order to incorporate those outside suggestions? Just speaking about what publishing a novel is, editors at publishers and literary agents don't care until you've got a finished product most of the time. If you aren't already connected with them, like Tope, I believe you may have connected through a story prize. You may have actually had an agent before you had a finished product.
Yeah.
But you can't approach an agent without a finished manuscript. An agent can approach you, but they don't want to hear from you if you have not finished a manuscript.
Exactly.
And definitely no editor or publisher. And bear in mind, that's different for nonfiction. There are nonfiction pitches for projects, but if you're speaking specifically about novels, you need a finished product before you even try to talk to someone else, because agents deal with thousands of queries every year. Editors deal with hundreds from agents. So in general, the process is pretty rigid, and you have to be done with you have to have at least a full completed manuscript before you go to the next phase. Tope, do you have anything that you would add to that?
I think you're exactly right on. I think that if you're interested in this, that you do have to have a solid book in place, and also and we've spoken about this before, a sense of what the novel can be in the world. Because part of what you're doing is, if you can make the agent's job easier, then you're making your life easier as well, right? And so the extent to which you can like create something that says, you know, like the book is in this family of books, you know, like agents are really fond of like positioning books with respect to other books so they can, you know, pitch it to editors as well. I think you should do that. I think you should think of yourself as like near the finish line and not towards the beginning of the race before you start that process.
I love this question. Why not read drama? I hear the importance of dialogue to your work.
Yeah, drama, look, I love, I'm not the kind of person who just reads fiction. I soak in everything, you know. I spend a lot of time at the museum. I watch lots of television, you know, including wonderful Bravo, you know, I do it all. And I think like you can't account for what's happening. I love sci-fi. So Star Trek is really important to me. You know, I watch the heck out of that. And you can't account for what's happening when you're taking in all these influences. But, you know, I just have this sense that, you know, it's sort of like eating. If you're missing some nutrient, like you might be drawn to that food and you might not know that you're being drawn to that food because your body needs it. I think as a creative, as an artist, that happens all the time, that you might be drawn to something. And I don't question it. Like, again, if I want to sit down and I'm like, I need to watch Star Trek right now, I'll watch it. And I know maybe there's something there that I need to, Riker is doing something that I need to kind of like take note of or something. So I've learned to not question that anymore. I just take in as much as I can and see what happens when I sit down to write.
So you mentioned Riker, meeting on my bookshelf.
Oh, you know what? I love that book. I read the heck out of that book in the sixth grade. I was like,
we just did it. So we are rewatching in my household, Star Trek: The Next Generation, one of my writer friends and her husband are also watching it home. So we have like a text thread where about half of it is Star Trek: The Next Generation comments back and forth, and so we end up in a book club reading Imzadi. Please don't read it again because it does not hold up.
Okay.
and not even just like as a professional writer side of things, like there's some things that probably should not have passed through the editorial phase of that book. Stephanie is over asking me to read the poem from Imzadi, and I will not read the poem out loud ever in public. But I was trying to avoid
the writing center after hours portion of this, right? So we'll take that up.
I'll stop the recording at some point, then I can read the poem to everyone who sticks around. But yeah, I agree. Listen, I don't read drama as much, but I do consider watching TV, watching films as part of, yeah, no different than reading.
Yeah.
I've not read this question in advance and it's really long. Okay, so I'm just gonna read it on the go.
Yeah.
My question is based on this. I'm guessing you don't come from a history of ancestors being enslaved. How do you position yourself as a Black man compared to Black Americans? I mean, the movement of BLM reminds Americans that Black lives are as important as white lives. I think, do you think Black Lives Matter is legit is the final question? And is the experience of more recent immigrants versus people with enslaved ancestors?
Yeah. So this is such a really important question, partly because I've spent so much of my life thinking about this. You know, like the thing about growing up the way that I did is that I grew up as an African American. And so, which is to say that people considered me, I mean, most of the time, especially when I'm meeting white people, they're not asking questions about where I come from or where my family comes from. They don't care, you know, just you're a Black person. But within a community, obviously, it's something that has come up and still continues to come up. And I would say a couple of things. I would say that, first of all, the kind of history of oppression extends beyond, obviously, the US borders. You know, like, so I'm emerging from a context in which colonialism played an incredibly important role in the sort of life of my family. My dad would tell a story when I was growing up about, with pride, and this is something that I learned to question later on. My dad would say that my grandfather, part of the reason that my grandfather was so successful in Nigeria was that when he was a boy and the British were coming around, they saw that he was able to learn English very quickly. He did really well in the colonial schools, and they decided that he should effectively be somebody who was successful in that society. And so when I was younger, that was a source of pride. Like, yes, I had a smart grandfather who had an English, he took an English name, and he kind of in the process of so doing, kind of took on more of British culture than perhaps some of his peers did. And then as I grew older and more radical, I thought like, wow, why did he do that? Like, why did he not like sort of stick it to the man? Why was he, you know? And so there's a kind of interesting set of questions that I was grappling with as I grew older. I am not the descendant of slaves, but I feel deeply within myself the kind of struggle, partly because I've experienced like this kind of contemporary manifestations of slavery, partly too because I emerged from a kind of worldwide diasporic Black sort of group of people who are consistently dealing with this. I think one of the reasons that Black Lives Matter has taken root across the world, not just in the US, but also in the UK, and there have been wonderful things that have happened in the UK. Right now, as we speak, there is a Zimbabwean Lives Matter movement that's happening in Zimbabwe, which is responding to some of the stuff I've said about colonialism and the kind of unique conditions there. And so I think there's a kind of worldwide awakening to the fact that Black folk have been held down across the world for various reasons. And that process starts, you know, in a really horrible, vicious, intangible way in Africa. And that's the genesis in terms of the slave trade, right? And so that's, I think, going back to that source too and thinking about what's happening in those places is deeply important. I have the great benefit of being in a space where I can kind of think about that African history because my parents are from there. And because I've spent my entire life in the US, more or less, I can think too about the history here and the fact that I married an African-American woman. And so I have, you know, kids who also have that, who have both histories, and to think about how that might impact them as well.
So to shift back again completely from the issues to the practice of writing.
Yeah.
How do you balance working full-time, writing, reading, two kids, family, glasses of wine, et cetera?
Glasses of wine, you answered them.
Question's over, good.
Look, I will not lie, it's difficult. You know, like I think the reason I'm had some success, I guess, is that just a lot of people in my life are showing me grace. My wife is showing me grace, you know, my kids are showing me grace. My boss at my job is showing me a lot of grace. My publishers are, just because it's really difficult. You know, I want to be a productive member of the creative / writing community and produce as much work as I can there. I want to keep a job and do well in my professional life as well. I want to, you know, be a great father, a great husband. And it's difficult to balance all of these. And, you know, I tend to be a disciplined person, that I tend to be somebody who like keeps a schedule. And that's been more difficult because of this kind of stay at home sort of order and everything else that's been associated with COVID-19. But I think part of it is just like recognizing that, you know, I might not respond to emails as quickly as I should. A couple of deadlines might slip here and there, but I'm trying my best to kind of be as multifaceted a person as I can be. And wine, I guess, I'm sorry.
And wine, always, yeah. And wine. So you mentioned a new novel project.
Yeah.
Are you willing to share what this project is, and with no being a perfectly acceptable answer in this case?
Yeah, I guess kind of. I've read a lot of pieces of late. They've been in the Times, New Republic, everywhere, about how there are a bunch of people are likely writing coronavirus novels right now. And I think that's really an interesting genre, like the idea that we're all writing novels about like how, yeah, too, like for those of us who aren't, you know, working in hospitals or grocery stores, like we're writing novels about the experience of like staying at home and how difficult that can be, which, you know, in some ways is kind of a first world problem. I'm interested in that, but I'm also interested in how to undercut that away. So maybe that's not even a teaser. Maybe that's just like more confusing than anything else, but I'm writing in that vein and we'll see what happens. But it's, I feel good about what I've written thus far. And I've said that many times in my life and then have looked at it and then said, you know what, time to press the delete button. But, you know, we'll see what happens with this.
The life of the writer in a nutshell.
Sure.
So on that, I just want to say, let's wrap up there. I'll leave the chat up for a few minutes after we're done so that those of us who want to discuss episodes of Star Trek The Next Generation can continue to do so. But the official chat is ending right now. Tope, thank you so much. I feel it's always great to talk to you. I have enjoyed it every time we've done it. So we'll make it like a monthly chat or something. I don't know.
Love it. Thank you so much. I really appreciate you for doing this so much. I thank all of you for coming out and participating in this as well. I really appreciate it.
Absolutely. You actually may have won attendance at our events too. So that's a plus too. Please go to writer.org to look at things like our upcoming workshop schedule, our upcoming event schedule, And if you're inclined to give a donation to the Writer Center's Scholarship Fund, you can do so there as well. Again, that's writer.org. I expect one of my colleagues will paste that into the chat window here shortly. And there it was. Thanks, Emily. We will be back next week and the week after and the week after. Just go to our events page on the Writer Center website to see what we have coming up. And that's what we're done for the day. Thank you so much for everyone coming out. I'll leave the chat up for a little while longer for so we can be social for a minute before everyone heads their separate ways. Thank you all for coming out. Have a good night.